good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on which time zone you're joining us from. It's 10 p.m. here in Singapore. Some people here might just be getting ready for their bedtime, but they're missing out on an exciting hour ahead of us. Let us know where you are watching from in the Q&A function available. It'll be really nice for our speakers here to know which countries are tuning in right now. Welcome to QS in Conversation Live. I'm Afifa Darki. I'm the deputy editor at QS Quaccarelli Simmons. In this episode of QS in Conversation Live, we have partnered with Tech de Monterrey, Universidad de Lima, and we will be looking at developing new competencies for students in the 21st century. Essentially, today, we'll be looking at what skills are employers looking for in students and graduates. How can universities and companies work together to create more opportunities for employment, and the challenges the higher education industry faces when it comes to this area, and how should institutions address such difficulties? This is a very important and timely topic, as all of you are joining us today for this very exciting conversation. Universities have started reopening and they are finding themselves in a different sort of normal, not the same before the pandemic happened. There's also an unprecedented digital transformation accelerated by COVID. The pandemic has also intensified pre-existing gender gaps and worsened employment prospects for many young people. So joining us today, we have a dream team of panelists, a fantastic lineup of speakers. Based in Mexico, we have Dr. Ignacio de la Vega. He is the Associate Provost for Academic Affairs, Faculty and Internationalization of Tecnológico de Monterrey. Previously, Dr. Ignacio was the Dean of Igadi Business School and the Graduate Business School at Tech de Monterrey. Before that, he was CEO of Global Babson, where he developed innovative programs and collaborative research initiatives with a focus on entrepreneurship. And from Peru, we have Dr. Patricia Stewart. She is the Vice President of Universidad de Lima. She is the former Dean of Faculty of Business and Economics, Director of the International Business Undergraduate Program at the same university. She's also the member of Latin America and Caribbean Advisory Council of the Association to Advance Collegiate School of Business. Last but not least, from Washington, D.C., we have Mercedes Mateo. She is Education Division Chief at the Inter-American Development Bank, where she leads an initiative to rethink education and strengthen the learning ecosystems to equip people with 21st century skills. Her work covers different areas of international development and social policy with a strong emphasis on inequality. And as with all of our QS in conversations, you, the audience, is very much part of the discussion as we are. So please comment, share your perspective, give your opinions, and please ask a lot of questions in the Q&A function that we have. And I'm sure the speakers will be more than happy to answer your questions. So let's get straight into it. Let's go to Dr. Ignacio first. Let me start off with you and ask you this question to start the scene. So job hunting for fresh graduates in the past 2 years has not been easy with the pandemic. Employers are starting to ask for different things and not necessarily skills that students are equipped with. From your observations in the past 2 years, how has COVID affected employers' demands for fresh graduates?
Well, thank you. Good morning, everyone. I see a lot of countries here in the chat. So good morning, wherever you are. And thank you, QS, for the invitation to Tecnológico de Monterrey. And let me reflect on your question. Looks like when we look 2 years ago, 2 years back, we tend to think that pandemic has been the main driver for change in our industry and in many others. And this is only partially true. The tendencies, the evolution, the changes that we were seeing and the need for reinvention at the higher education industry were way before the pandemic. But definitely pandemic has served as an accelerator, as I was mentioning. Let's only think that on the way we work today, before pandemic, some maybe 7% of Americans used to work remotely. We saw in the pandemic a large number of population moving to remote working, 60% of American workers. It was lower in Latin America, and unfortunately that was because of our the lack of resources that a large percentage of the population did have to stay home. They needed to go out and find jobs and find food. So that was a big impact. But again, it's only the tip of the iceberg. Let's talk about gig working. This division of work, labor among humans, machines, algorithms, things that we see every day, we have it in our smartphone, but sometimes we don't know what it means and how to use it. This was something that it was previous to pandemic, but at the pandemic is going, or is affecting the way we work, the way we learn, and the demands of our graduates from the industry. There's some numbers. I was reading Gartner the other day, and you're familiar with these numbers. By 2025, 85 million existing jobs today in our countries, in our industries, will be lost, which is bad and tragic. But this gig working, the intersection between technology, humans, new demands of industries, the digital transformation, will create 100 million new jobs. So this is a gain win for our markets, for our institutions, and definitely brings new responsibilities on how we educate our graduates. And I will come back to that in a minute. And most of those jobs will be skill-based. And let me clarify here a little bit what we understand as skills. In 2019, at Tecnológico de Monterrey, we launched our new educational model. I will elaborate on that in the second question, but it's a new way of delivering education. It's based on a few pillars, and it's surrounded by a competency-based definition. So our model is designed to develop the necessary skills depending on the industry and the discipline for our graduates. And by skills, we are not only talking about what we traditionally understand as soft skills. A skill in the definition is a combination of disciplinary knowledge and these power skills that we all need to succeed. So this has been really accelerated by pandemic and a few years before. And today the profile of employers are looking for, or the entrepreneurs are looking for, is completely different from what it used to be, let's say 5 years ago. This brings an opportunity for us, definitely. I mean, how do we transform our educational model to serve this need of a specialized technical, disciplinary knowledge and competencies in our graduates, in our communities, but also it's a big challenge. It's a big challenge because as an industry, we are not known as moving real fast and responding to changes in the environment. And I think it was Peter Drucker who mentioned that if the speed of change and transformation outside in our industry, in our market is larger than the one we do have at our institutions, we might be dead in a few years. So this is a serious challenge for us. And finishing this, the pandemic came, got us into a complete new mindset, the new needs, new ways of doing everything from learning to entertaining, to traveling, to working. But after pandemic, what we've seen is that the transformation is speeding up. And unfortunately, we see this situation of war, we see the inflation ramping up, we see shortages of supply chains, we see prices of energy skyrocketing. So we see a lot of challenges that are exacerbating this need of doing education in a completely different way. As a result of this, and the biggest challenge we have today will be, in my opinion, around employability and return on investment for the education industry. So big changes. And as Chinese, and I see there are some Chinese people in the chat, said, Wei Ji meaning, of course, there are big challenges for us as educators, but also big opportunities. Wei Ji combines challenge with opportunity. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ignacio, for setting the scene. You touched on several things, such as gig work and how jobs are now going to be skill-based compared to 5 years ago. Dr. Patricia, you've been in the industry for a while with many years of your career in the business school environment. From your perspective, what are today's highly desired skills from employers, specifically in Latin America, but which are lacking in the graduates today? And why are they lacking in such skills?
Well, I consider there are many skills, but I chose like 10 key skills that are desired in the job market now. for our graduates. The first one is the learning capacity, learn to learn. It's necessary to learn how to use the knowledge already learned to acquire new skills that respond to changing emerging needs. As Toffler stated, illiterates of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And that's true now. Some indicators that we are graduates already got that skill are if they are able to focus, to organize, to self-assessment, and to be perseverant. Another one is how they handle the frustration and if they are able to adapt to different contexts. It's very important skill for Generation Z, those born from the late 90s to early 2010s. They must learn that mistakes are setbacks and they are part of life. The important thing is to know how to handle them and to achieve success. And some indicators that our graduates and other graduates are learning that skill is if they are willing to participate in different changes that we have at the university, if they are tolerant, if they are flexible to generate new responses to new situations like the pandemic. Another one I find very important is collaboration. We are in a hyper-connected world, and that demands to know how to collaborate with teams, regardless of the location. And knowing how to collaborate, share knowledge, and contribute in teams is very important for the job market now. And one very hard to get is that graduates must be very good in verbal and written communication. Now they know how to sell the products, to express their ideas, to make an elevator pitch if necessary, and how to develop and send a message for different audiences. I also find that creativity and innovation are very important in this 21st century. And that's important because they learn how to imagine a future possibility. So how can we develop in graduates curiosity, questioning, and research is very helpful for them to develop new ideas and solutions to current problems. So we have to offer in our programs a space for to be original, to be productive, open-minded. And also they have to learn not only soft skills, but hard skills, because problem solving and decision making are very important for different sectors of the economy now. So they have to learn also quantitative tools to be able to conceptualize a situation and to make fact-based decisions. That includes critical thinking. They have to be able to analyze the truthfulness of a fact or information. Nowadays, we have a world with fake news, and they have to be able to learn and to know how to analyze and follow an information that you can prove with facts. So information and data management is a must. They are in a world of constant information demands. They have to be able to analyze, contrast, evaluate, organize information. And the most important for our graduates are leadership. They have to learn to train, to motivate, and lead high-performance teams. And especially in South America, with different communities and the high diversity we have in Peru, for instance, they have to be able to negotiate with communities and native communities to achieve the company objective. Like in the mining companies, we have a lot of problems there, and they have to learn not only to adequate to different contexts, but to negotiate with different cultures inside the same country. And last but not least, technology and computational thinking. Technology is changing at an unprecedented pace, so it's very important to teach them strategies to manage any type of technology. And I think that if we provide a powerful base of soft and hard skills, the educational system can serve not only to our graduates to adapt to future jobs, but also for an improved quality of life in our region.
Thanks, Dr. Patricia. Thanks for that. Mercedes, given the multitude of changes as mentioned by Dr. Ignacio and Dr. Patricia, what are your thoughts on the impact these have had on the access to education, specifically in Latin America? How has the pandemic exacerbated inequality in education, and how does that in turn affect students' ability to learn in universities and get the skills that are required to get jobs?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first, hello, everyone. Glad to see so many people connected from different parts of the world. A pleasure to be here. Thank you, Afifa, for the question, because I think it's critical. As you know, that the Latin American and Caribbean region is one of the most unequal regions in the world. During the pandemic, for those of you who don't know the numbers, about 168 million young people got disconnected, and they lost on average 237 days of school. Those were the numbers at the end of 2021 last year. So that was the longest school closures around the world. And so now what the evidence shows that is that due to this disruption in face-to-face instruction, there was a drastic reduction in the number of hours dedicated by students and teachers to academic activities. One out of two students did not participate in any type of learning activity during this time or had any interactions with teachers. Given that digital divide, on top of that, that was also produced by the digital divide that exists, and most of the countries in the region could not provide quality online instruction, especially to those students that came from most vulnerable contexts. Just as an example, 78% of students under the age 17 who are in public schools do not have access to the internet, and only 19% have a computer at home. Also very important, in public schools, in rural areas, synchronous interactions between teachers and students were less frequent given their low access to virtual education programs. Another very important issue that I want to mention here is the case of young women, because it's particularly concerning in a region that closed over the last decades the gender gap, at least in terms of educational achievement and completion. So one of the things that happened is that the number of hours that girls age between 15 and 17 year old that they spend on domestic activities such as cleaning, cooking, or taking care of younger children or the elderly increased by 18% during the lockdowns, compared to 2% only of their young males counterparts. So that's also a very significant number to put into the equation of how is learning and how is inequality pervasive for the learning and the eventually all those kids and young people getting into higher education programs and getting the right skills. Another important factor that affected learning and readiness of the students was the loss of employment of the adults in the household. So that is very much connected to students dropping out of school. And so that's also a very important and negative effect of the pandemic. The percentage of youth in households whose head was not employed increased in nearly 6 percentage points in all countries during 2020. And fewer hours, of course, dedicated to academic work is also associated with poor performance, higher probability of dropping out of school. And an estimate, we've seen about 3.5 million students leaving school But the probability, and given the number of lower number of hours per week spent studying by students during the pandemic, we have estimated that the probability of dropout for students aged between 12 to 17 increased by 13%. And that's important in a region in which pre-pandemic, we already have one out of two students finishing secondary education. So why did we see all of that? Why the pandemic hit so hard in the region? It wasn't just the pandemic, of course, it was the fact that the region and its education systems were not well prepared to endure a transitory shock of this magnitude. So I always like to emphasize that we cannot understand the short and long-term effects of the crisis without really considering the initial conditions. The school closures came on top of structural deficiencies that have remained unsolved in education systems in Latin American and Caribbean region over the past decades. So I've talked a lot about engagement, student engagement, number of hours, the fact that the students were not finalizing pre-pandemic secondary education, but now connecting with the skills, are the students ready? Were the students ready? Pre-pandemic already, there were a number of things that were not unsolved in terms, and were not solved in terms of learning. By third grade, 48% of students did not master basic math concepts, and over 50% did not read and understand text as they should. Patricia was mentioning before, and she was paying a lot of attention to the 21st century skills, critical thinking, communication, leadership. A student cannot learn how to think critically if she or he cannot understand a text. So the students were lagging behind in foundational skills. I already mentioned the problem of access in terms of finalizing secondary education. Students cannot go into higher education, post-secondary programs, if they don't finish secondary education. And then, of course, the issue of education not being a leveler of opportunities for all of them. So given the current circumstances, if nothing is done, our estimates show that youth in Latin America and the Caribbean will see a decrease in annual earnings of between $15,000 and $30,000 during their lifetimes due to lower educational achievement. And this will translate at a macro level on an impact of $760 billion in the Latin American and Caribbean economies, equivalent, that could be equivalent to as much as 17% of the GDP.
Thanks, Mercedes. I think the statistics that you shared really emphasize how access to education was really affected, especially after COVID. So we've talked about the desired skills and what employers are looking for. I think the next area to address is really how to close the skills gap. Dr. Ignacio, in recent years, you've been an investor in several startups as well and small, medium enterprises. With that knowledge in the industry, how can higher education institutions and industries work together and collaborate to address this skills gap?
Thank you, Afifa. This is a critical question, definitely. I'm going to try to give examples for this question. And the best example I can give is, I mentioned before, the launch in August 2019 of Tech 21st, the educational model of Tech Monterrey, is a challenge-based learning approach to education. Meaning by this that we necessarily put together our faculty with existing industries, entrepreneurial ventures, governments, NGOs, designing the challenges that the students will solve throughout the academic period. So this sounds like something pretty basic. Definitely from an operational perspective for us, a 60,000 undergraduate university, it takes some challenges in operating and in maintaining the interest in our in our partners. But let me give you a couple of examples. This thing about getting together industries and universities has been long in the market. And you might recall the German dual education system, some attempts also done in Singapore and some other geographies of working together with the industry and developing these skills that the graduates really need to succeed and have a higher employability out there. As I mentioned, August 2019, I was serving as dean at the Gaddy Business School and the business school at Tech de Monterrey, 18,000 students. And we had the day one of our new Tech 21st model. And we started with a real challenge with a real company for our 4,000 new entry students. The company was Coppel. The challenge was the new role of business in society, putting together all these ideas about how business can become more conscious and getting the students in team, working with the company, the Coppel, and the faculty that design and develop the challenge throughout 5 weeks. If you look at this, looks like something simple to put together. Now, if you bring this into 4 years of education and scale this to 4,000 companies that we need in our model in the different disciplines, in all the different programs and careers, things get, from an operational perspective, really complicated. From the impact in our students, really huge. Let me give you a second example I use often. So in one of these visits we do to large companies all over the world, the footprint of our graduates at Tech de Monterrey is global, and it's also multidisciplinary. They are in our disciplines, working in the US or in Asia or in Europe or in Mexico or in LATAM. And we were visiting Bloomberg. Bloomberg, you all know, this financial and technology company specialized in the couple of markets, as I mentioned. And I was talking to the CEO and to the head of talent. And the question was simple. What are you looking for in the graduates of universities like us that are joining your company? And the talent guy mentioned a list of competencies, skills. Some were mentioned by Patricia. Some others are common to you. There are every couple of days a list of the top competencies or skills that our graduates need to have. And he mentioned a list similar to that, entrepreneurial vision and complexity management and multicultural remote working and all the list. And my question was, what about having solid disciplinary knowledge? I mean, you're a financial company, so you might need financial knowledge guys or expertise, and you're also a technology company, so you might need a combination of both. And the guy said, oh yeah, if these guys don't have the best financial or technology or combined financial and technology education, the other skills won't count because they will not go through our interview system. What I mean by this is, how do we define skills? And sometimes we tend to define in what used to be soft skills. I like to call them much better power skills. And I think this has been a definition adopted by the industry as well. And in this definition, we definitely put together disciplinary knowledge content with these skills that make us more appealing to industry. One last comment on that. Why is it difficult for us in higher education? I'm not generalizing, of course, because we have not changed as much as our environment. We are still organized quite rigidly in silos defined by discipline. The disciplines do their management and develop their educational model at some point. And the market out there is organized not by silos, but by skills and by technical. And this disconnects a lot what we are trying to instill in our students with what is required and needed out there. So how do we break the silos? How do we bring more interdisciplinarity? And coming back to the question, how do we connect to actual businesses and industries out there? Again, businesses in a wide definition might be entrepreneurial ventures, might be governments, might be NGOs. How do we connect our students from an earlier stage with those organizations in which they are going to serve? I think this is the biggest challenge we do have. And I invite you to go through the materials of Tech 21st and understand this challenge-based learning concept. Of course, it's in our website at Tecnológico de Monterrey. There was a beautiful case written by International Finance Corporation and Tech 21st and the different pillars of the model. So you can get some insights over there. Thank you for the question.
Thanks for that, Dr. Ignacio. I'll actually like to ask the same question to Dr. Patricia. As the vice president at the university, how can universities in Latin America tackle this skills gap that we were talking about? What are the challenges that they face when attempting to close this skills gap?
Thank you, Afifa. Well, I will try to add something else to Dr. Ignacio. I think in Latin America, we are running a race against time to tackle the skills gap due to the pace of the fourth industrial revolution. As there is a short interval available to build the training systems and labor market institutions necessary to develop new skill sets. According to the OECD, closing the skill gap will require solid understanding of the current skill base, talent management strategies, and sustained dialogue among companies, governments, and education providers. But in the majority of our countries, in Latin American countries, cognitive goals continue to dominate, and intrapersonal competence receive less emphasis in the educational system. All the education stakeholders, including funders, policymakers, researchers, practitioners, especially parents and public, need to understand about the importance, the content, and the competencies necessary for the 21st century. I was reading a Catalyzing Education 4.0 report. They estimated that investment in critical skills for the future, such as collaborative problem solving, could add an additional $2.54 trillion in increased productivity to the global economy, with highest relative gains in sub-Saharan Africa and Latin America and the Caribbean country. And I think that it's the same in every report I can read from the World Economic Forum report. They estimate by 2025, around 85 million jobs may be lost because we are entering to a new era, the fourth industry revolution. So there will be a change in division of labor. So that we will have machines, algorithms, humans, but that is a new opportunity because they estimate that another number like more than 95 million more jobs may emerge. It would be great if our region could be better adapted to the new dynamic. So I think the impact of the digital revolution in LATAM will depend on how well prepared are our countries to take advantage of these opportunities. And in the Latin American region, there are still, as Mercedes pointed, a lot of gaps and inequalities that prevent achievement of inclusive social development. We have an existing inequality for centuries in the quality of education provided, and it was exposed in the COVID-19 pandemic. And that is a problem that universities try to solve because we are receiving newcomers, freshmen, freshwomen, that were 2 years in distant education. And now they need to gain again how to work in teams, in person, how to write and how to compose and how to make presentations in person, which is we have to solve those gaps, and we're doing now. I'm still teaching a subject and for newcomers, and I find it very, very interesting to see how they are used to work by themselves, and now they have to gather and they have to work together. But I think businesses, governments, universities, we need to work together to close those gaps. The challenges in universities in Latin America are especially to develop digital fluency. Of course, as Mercedes said, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, what they call STEM skills, especially for women, for girls and women. And we need that they learn the basic digital literacy, and they can apply that to critical thought, ethical consideration, and use that skills to develop technology or deal with data. Another challenge is to develop soft skills. I know they are important for the job market, but they have to relearn that because they have to integrate the content of the theory with practices that are relevant to the market, and also connect them to the society. They have to be socially responsible in a different way.
Thanks, Dr. Patricia. Mercedes, so you come from a slightly different perspective than Dr. Ignacio and Dr. Patricia, since you are from an international organization. How have you seen governments or countries help their universities to respond to the changing skills demands, and what are their challenges, actually?
Yeah, thank you, Atifa, for the question. I want to start answering by capturing two ideas that both Patricia and Ignacio mentioned. One is the race against time. Governments do not have time. They need to act quickly, and we are really running against the clock. And the other idea that is very much connected that Ignacio raised is we have not changed as much as our environment. So there is a disconnect between what we are living today and how ready we are, our readiness level in terms of what we have done, right? So the enabling environment, so to speak, from the government perspective. I just wanna also mention in that context that data is very, very, I think, very illustrative of that. During the last 30 years, productivity in the region has grown at a rate of 1% per year, which is extremely slow compared with other regions. So, and behind that slow productivity increases is that the fact that the region lags behind in three fronts: innovation, business climate, and skills. We've been talking a lot about skills, both Patricia and Ignacio and myself before. So we know that the workers lag in skills, that we know. We also, and I don't wanna elaborate more about what the skills that the companies need, 21st century skills are heavily emphasized, or power skills, as Ignacio mentioned. I think somebody in the chat was asking, well, are those, what are more important, the hard skills, the soft skills, or the power skills and the hard skills? I think it's a combination between the two industry-specific skills. The issue with the industry-specific skills, of course, is that they tend to perish. So we need to renew and work with investing in renewing those skills. I think a recent survey showed that 40% that the industry thinks that about 40% of workers will need to go into upskilling and reskilling programs, training programs right now of the staff they already have on board. So these are kind of the, and of those industries, about 90, they think that about 90% of the workers will need to upgrade their skills through the work that they are already doing. So this is the massive amount of investment that we need to do to upskill and reskill workers, in which, of course, the government, Afifa, to your question, has an important role. So now, what is the challenges and opportunities that governments in the region are facing right now? One has to do with the fact that The global education and training expenditure today, it's more than a $3 trillion industry in the world. An estimate says that education expenditure will grow from 10 to about, so from these $6 trillion to about $10 trillion in 2030. So this is gonna be, according to estimates, one of the fastest growing sectors around the world. Compared to other industries, EdTech represents a very small portion of that amount, of that global education market. Less than 3% is digital spend, which means that there is still a lot of room for growth in the coming years. And now if we take that number into the region, what does it represent? So the sector in the region, EdTech sector in Latin America and in the Caribbean only represents 2% of the worldwide EdTech industry. That's what we are talking about. So this is indicating that the sector has clearly an incipient degree of development for the size and the amount of the challenges that we are facing, as both Patricia and Ignacio mentioned, in a world in which we know that in a world that we know is digital, basically. So this is one of the big challenges besides inequality that I already mentioned before. Now, what are the opportunities? What are the opportunities not just for the private sector, but for governments? What are the things that we should leverage on? One is that enrollment in higher education, post-secondary education in the region has increased and is more diversified than ever. So the enrollment moved from 19% in 1999 to 52% in 2019, just before the pandemic. So this is great. And what we've seen is that an access of lower income population has also increased, as well as women. So those are the good news, those are the factors that we were coming on a positive trend until COVID hit the region. So that's something positive. However, we are still behind OECD countries where the enrollment is about on average 75%. Positive thing in terms of access, or at least some positive trends. Also digitalization, it's a very important trend that we need to jump on. This is a great opportunity. Digitalization of the sector is a great opportunity to democratize and diversify the supply of post-secondary education programs and services. On the challenges side, again, it's of course that we need more institutional capacity. We need to strengthen the institutional capacity. We need to strengthen the talent that works in those higher education institutions. In a recent study that we published together with HolonIQ, we show that one out of three higher education institutions in the region that participated in our study say that digital learning is key for the future of their organizations. Both Patricia and Ignacio were sharing their experiences in their own organizations, but they also say that they don't have the digital maturity necessary to make that change, to make that transition. So teachers don't have the digital skills, and the same happens with the administrative staff. I think also in terms of opportunities, the diversification and the expansion of the supply of different programs, it's an opportunity. But at the same time, and I move into the opportunity to the challenge situation, it doesn't seem to be a priority for those higher education institutions in the region. So that is also something that we need to, from the government side, we need to push and support the higher education institutions to make that diversification of programs with quality, which is another issue. So I want to mention here that even if we have a strengthening in the region the programs to for quality assurance. We still have a long way to go. Low quality of programs in a context of diversification will mean that the relevance of those programs and the skills that students get through those programs will be lower, and therefore the disconnect between what the labor market needs and what the education systems and higher education institutions produce will continue, will remain to be the same. Just to close with that, Afifa, is that I want to emphasize the fact that countries are working to close these gaps. We are supporting Peru, Belize, Costa Rica, Colombia, Mexico, different countries in the region, in a combination of strengthening and supporting the digital transformation of traditional institutions, universities, but TVET, so technical vocational institutions as well. But also what we are seeing is that countries and governments are supporting the diversification of other programs in combination with the private sector. And this is very important because one of the things that we've seen, particularly today, it's fundamental to strengthen the ecosystem. Both public and private sectors need to work together. And we've seen that we are partnering, for example, with Netflix, with universities. We have a long-term collaboration with the Tec de Monterrey. We are also collaborating with the universities in Peru. With Netflix, for example, we've been doing for the past little bit more than a year, we've been doing gap analysis to see what are the skills mismatch between what the industry, audiovisual sector industry needs and what the region has. And we are right now doing a sandbox pilot in Colombia to actually develop those skills in youth. So what's interesting here is that the private sector is actually willing to pay for closing that skills gap.
Thank you so much, Mercedes. While the speakers have been talking, the audience have been asking so many questions, and I think we just have to jump into one of the questions that that's being asked. I'd like to ask Dr. Ignacio, we have a question from someone who said, are we too dependent on schools? So are we too dependent on the traditional structure of university? Have we not equipped our students with the self-ability to the skill to learn themselves, which is an important point raised by Dr. Stewart, according to this audience. So Dr. Ignacio, why is it so difficult to teach students such competencies such as critical thinking, teamwork, or ethical values? If you could just say it very quickly so we can also move on to other Q&As, that would be great.
Yes, thank you. I'll try to be quick on this. Definitely things like critical thinking, teamwork, ethical values, collaboration, I don't know, complexity management, any of the skills, also called soft skills. I mean, the truth is that they cannot be taught with traditional models. And we need to teach them or make our learners get these skills by doing, through challenges, through real problems. And this requires a big change in our educational models. There was a question about this. Francis Lee, very active on the chat, was asking about why these soft skills are more difficult to teach. And I think we need a better definition of what are we talking about here when we mention from an educational perspective skills. I'll give you ours, Tec de Monterrey. I translate it into English, so apologies for that. But we define a skill by a conscious or likely conscious integration of knowledge, abilities, attitudes, and values. We didn't talk about values here, and it's a relevant thing now. The purpose that our students bring, the purpose that our institutions really want to foster. So again, conscious integration of knowledge, abilities, attitudes, and values that allows to confront our learners, of course, to confront successfully structured, complex, and changing situations. So if we get this wider definition, then we start to understand much better what needs to be or what can be taught with traditional learning pedagogies, or what needs to move into a completely different mindset from the perspective of the professor and the educational model. Let me finish by saying that Our model today is competency-based rounded, and we do have two types of competencies or skills, definitely the disciplinary ones defined by each school, by each discipline, they belong to each professional area, and the transversals that apply to the whole population of high school students, undergraduate students and graduate students. And these are seven, and I will just mention them and move to the next speaker. Self-knowledge and self-management. This is number one. Entrepreneurial mindset, and I would need 1 hour to go. This is my topic as a professor, entrepreneurship, so entrepreneurial mindset. Social intelligence, citizenship and ethical values. I would add purpose. In our vision, we are one of the main parts of our Tech Demonstrate vision, it's a human flourishing. So ethical values and purpose, complexity management and reasoning, communication, finally, digital transformation. So these are our transversal skills. And one last comment, definitely they are subjected to change. We cannot design an educational model and believe that this is going to last 10 years, 20 years, as used to be the case. So we launched this model in 2019, and we are now looking towards 2026, in a couple of years, where we will refine, refresh, and relaunch our new educational model. This is the speed we need in education, unless we want to, become irrelevant. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ignacio. A lot of insights there. Quickly to Dr. Patricia, I know you have some views on this. So what are the difficulties in teaching the skills that Dr. Ignacio was referring to, especially in such a digitized world?
Well, thank you, Afifa. Yes, there are some difficulties in trying to teach those skills. And as Dr. Ignacio mentioned, we are always trying to improve our educational model too at the Universidad de Lima. And of course, it's a challenge for us. We have to go, our students and our graduates, they work in the modern, economic part of the country. But in my country, in Peru, more than, I would say, 60% of the population works in an informal sector. So there is a challenge. Some of our students are the first generation of students who come to the university. Their parents couldn't afford and couldn't have university studies. So we have to work very hard with them. But I think I'm not so, I don't think there are so many problems now because we are working with Generation Z, those who were born around 2010. So they are our students, they were born like 17 years ago, and they are very keen to learn new things. They are very keen to work in groups. They are looking for creating groups to gasp whatever information they are able to look in the internet. If the values you are teaching are of their interest. So I think this generation also thinks that they are in charge of changing the world. They have inherited a very complex world problems. Well, especially we have the war in Europe, but in South America, we have a very difficult turning point in political situation for many of our countries are turning to a different structure of government. So they are living this, they survive the pandemic, they learn very fast to work in digital environments. So I have high hopes for this generation. I think it's difficult. Mercedes mentioned all the economic inequalities, but I think we can surpass them, we can work. And I think we are investing a lot of money also for helping teachers, helping educators in our institution to move on and to go in the same pace of our students. They are a different generation. They learn very fast. They were born with internet. So they although understand if you talk something about the 80s or 90s, that's the old century. So I think we have to keep pace with them, work teaching new skills for our teachers. And I'm very hopeful that if universities and educators go to the same pace of Generation Z, we can improve that skill gap very soon.
Thanks, Dr. Patricia. And very quickly, Mercedes, we have about 4 minutes left, so we're gonna give you about 2 minutes. I know you were you attended a conference about alternative credentials. So what's your take on this? Like, are we too dependent on traditional universities?
Yeah, thank you, Afifa. And I'm going to connect the answer to your question to some of to two of the questions that were sent in the chat so that we kill two birds with one stone, so to speak. Sorry for the aggressive language. And there was one question on diversification of education and the drive towards commercialization and the importance of NASCO, the issue of nationalizing education. So very quickly, I think, as I mentioned before, one challenge in the region is low productivity. So even if we've seen important progress in terms of access to education, as I mentioned, we know that what really makes a difference, and Ignacio mentioned something about that, is skills accumulation, not years of education. And I want to start by that because that puts the context into, so we think that spending four years in college, 5 years in college, it's gonna make a difference. That's what we've been growing into. And that somehow has a connection, is true with productivity and with income. However, I just wanna emphasize that what really makes the difference is that skills accumulation, and therefore the emphasis on the different types of skills that we gain through education. So in that context, are universities still relevant? The answer is yes. Are alternative credentials or this diversification that we were talking about is relevant? Yes. I believe that they are going to coexist. I'm also, as Patricia, I tend to be optimistic about the future. I think the fact that we are diversifying, if we do it right, if we do it with quality, it's gonna allow us to democratize access to relevant training for all of us, for our youth. And it's gonna lower the cost because 4 or 5 year degrees, we all know, are costly. And it's gonna help us close the mismatch between skills and so what the market needs and what the education produces much faster than with traditional degree programs. So first point is about coexistence, very important. The other thing is that in that context, and that goes into the commercialization question that was done, is that not just the private sector, but also, for example, the US federal government has realized that degrees might not be necessary for all their new hires. So they are basing their hires on skills, not necessarily on degrees, also certificates, the paper. And that I think it's a trend very important. And I want to emphasize that not just on the private sector side, but also on the public sector side. And one last point, and I stop here, is about why alternative credentials are important, because of portability and stackability. Why? We are going to be lifelong learners. And in that context, we need to think of flexible, short ways of training our human capital, training our talent. So it's important that those credentials are stackable, so that you can accumulate over your lifetime different trainings and different skills that build up into what you're gonna be doing in the market.
Thank you so much, Mercedes. I think that's all the time that we have for today. Thank you to all our speakers, Dr. Ignacio, Dr. Patricia, and Mercedes for joining me today. Thank you to the audience for also joining us and asking so many questions, spending the past hour listening to this discussion and being part of it. We're really sorry for not getting to all the questions, but we will try to answer them and post them on our website. The recording will also be available at qsinconversation.com. Before you leave, I would like to invite everybody here to everybody here who's interested in hearing more about higher education to join us at our upcoming June events. For those who are willing to travel to Paris, QS is organizing the Western Europe Global Impact Forum on June 28th. This forum will provide universities with the opportunity to have consultations about their performance with the QS consulting team and learn more about how students consult rankings. And if you are unable to travel to Paris, like myself, please join our QS Higher Ed Summit at QS Higher Ed Summit Europe, which will be held virtually on June 28th to 30th. The summit will include a live stream portion of the Western Europe Global Impact Forum and feature sessions around the main theme, crisis management, remaking European higher education amid unfolding social realities. We will be sending the registrations link via email later this week. So on behalf of the team here in Singapore, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.